Welcome back to my sixth video on this series of lectures on special theory of relativity. In this video, I will discuss the variation of mass with velocity or speed of a body. It is well known that the property that characterizes the inertia of a body is its mass. Further, it is known that when a force is applied on a body, it will impart an acceleration to it, the direction of this acceleration being the same as that of the force. A given force F will impart different accelerations A to bodies of different masses, and different forces will impart different accelerations to bodies of a fixed mass. However, the ratio of the force to the acceleration is always a constant, that is, F divided by A equals to a constant given the symbol m for the given body. This ratio is nothing but the mass of the body. It turns out that this ratio, that is F by A, is a constant only for small speeds, that is speed v being very much less than c, the speed of light. If the speed of a body is increased, then the ratio F by A begins to vary. As a matter of fact, it begins to increase with the speed of the body. This means the inertial properties of the body are manifested more strongly at higher speeds. We will now determine how the mass, that means which is the measure of the inertia property of the body, depends on the speed of the body. We will approach this problem by considering the law of conservation of linear momentum between two bodies. Let us consider two reference frames S and S dash. Let the frame S dash move with a speed V along the positive X axis. The Y and Z axis of the frames are parallel. Consider a collision between two bodies, 1 and 2, of masses M1 and M2 respectively, moving in opposite directions with equal magnitudes of velocity U dash in the frame S. Let's apply the law of conservation of linear momentum for the collision between two bodies in the frame S dash. The total momentum before collision must be equal to the total momentum after collision. Thus, we have M1 U dash minus M2 U dash must be equal to M1 plus M2 times Vs dash, or Vs dash is equal to 0. Thus, the coalesced body after collision remains at rest as seen from the frame S dash. Now, let us consider the collision from the point of view of the observer in the frame S. By using the inverse Lorentz transformation, we can obtain the velocities of the two bodies before collision as seen from the frame S as U1 equal to U dash plus V divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared, and U2 equal to minus U dash plus V divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared. Now, the velocity of the coalesced body will be Vs equal to 0 plus V divided by 1 plus 0 by C squared, which is equal to V itself, that is the velocity of the frame itself. Now, according to the law of conservation of linear momentum, for the observer in the frame S, we may write M1 U1 plus M2 U2, which is the total momentum before collision, equal to M1 plus M2 times Vs. So, when we substitute the value of U1, U2 and Vs in the formula M1 U1 plus M2 U2 equal to M1 plus M2 times V, we obtain the first step M1 times U dash plus V divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared plus M2 times minus U dash plus V divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared is equal to M1 plus M2 times V. There are a few simplification steps. At first, we try to combine all the terms of M1 and M2 together and equate the right hand side to 0. And then we separate the terms M1 and M2 on either side of the equation, obtaining M1 times U dash plus V divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared minus V is equal to M2 times V minus U dash plus V divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared, which is shown as equation 1 in this slide. Further simplification leads to the final result M1 by M2 is equal to 1 plus U dash V by C squared divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared. This is a purely mathematical step. Consider the term 1 minus U1 squared by C squared. Now, when we substitute for the value of U1 as U dash plus V divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared and go through a series of simplifications, we can obtain the result 1 minus U1 squared by C squared is equal to 1 minus U dash squared by C squared times 1 minus V squared by C squared whole divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared whole squared. In the previous slide, we obtained equation 1 as shown in this slide as 1 minus U1 squared by C squared equals 1 minus U dash squared by C squared times 1 minus V squared by C squared whole divided by 1 plus U dash V by C squared whole squared. Now, if you replace U1 by U2 and U dash by minus U dash, we obtain 1 minus U2 squared by C squared equal to 1 minus U dash squared by C squared times 1 minus V squared by C squared whole divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared whole squared as shown by equation 2. Now, dividing equation 2 by equation 1, we obtain equation 3, which is 1 minus U2 squared by C squared divided by 1 minus U1 squared by C squared equals 1 plus U dash V by C squared whole squared divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared. In the last slide, the last step was 1 minus U2 squared by C squared divided by 1 minus U1 squared by C squared equal to 1 plus U dash V by C squared whole divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared whole squared as shown in equation 3. We had earlier proved M1 by M2 is equal to 1 plus U dash V by C squared divided by 1 minus U dash V by C squared as shown in equation 4. Thus, when we compare equation 3 and 4, we may write M1 by M2 whole squared equal to 1 minus U2 squared by C squared divided by 1 minus U1 squared by C squared. Cross multiplying after taking square roots on both sides, we can finally write as shown in equation 6, M1 into root of 1 minus U1 squared by C squared equal to M2 times root of 1 minus U squared by C squared. Now, as you will notice, the two sides of equation 6 must be equal to the same constant. In other words, the LHS and RHS of equation 6 are independent of one another. And the above result can be true only if each of the term is equal to the same constant, say M0. The constant M0, which will be called as rest mass, will correspond to the mass of a body when it has no velocity or is at rest with respect to the observer. We note from equation 6 that if U1 equal to U2 equal to 0, M1 will be equal to M2 equal to a constant M0. Thus, in general, if M denotes the mass of a body when it is moving with the speed V with respect to an observer, and if M0 is its rest mass, that is the mass when it is at rest with respect to the same observer, then we may write as shown in equation 7, M is equal to M0 divided by square root of 1 minus V squared by C squared. This equation tells us how the mass of a body depends on the speed of the motion of. Let's take a look at the relativistic formula for the variation of mass with speed. At first, we note that as the speed of the body tends to 0, the mass of the body tends to its rest mass M0. And as the speed of the body tends to C, the speed of light, the mass of the body tends to infinity. This means material objects moving at the speed of light would have infinite mass. In other words, material objects cannot have a speed greater than C. In fact, even reaching C is impossible. Of course, the velocity or speed of the body can approach c as close to c as possible. The variation of mass with speed of the body is shown graphically below. The second point I would like to mention here is that the relativistic mass increase with speed is significant only at values of v close to c. Subatomic particles such as electrons, protons, mesons, etc. have sufficiently high speeds for relativistic effects to be significant and measurable. Further, in dealing with such particles, the Newtonian expressions for momentum and kinetic energy, etc., cannot be used. Historically, the first verification of the equation m equal to m naught divided by square root of 1 minus v squared by c squared was done by Bucher in 1908. He showed that the ratio E by m for an electron, where E is its charge and m is the mass, in fact E by m is called the specific charge of the electron, has a smaller value as the speed of the electron in. We finally note that the relativistic momentum p is defined as mass times velocity v, where m is written as m naught by root of 1 minus v squared by c squared. Further, Newton's second law will now be written as f is equal to dp by dt or d by dt of mv. Since both m and v are a function of time, we now have f is equal to m into dv by dt plus v into dm by dt. We thus come to the end of this video number 6 in the series of lectures on special theory of relativity. In this video, we saw that the mass of a body is a function of its speed. Of course, mass varies with speed, but this variation becomes important only when the speed of the body is very high, close to speed of light. Elementary particles such as electrons, protons, etc., and cosmic ray particles have speeds close to speed of light, and the variation of their mass with their speed has been experimentally verified. In the next video, we will talk about relativistic kinetic energy and also derive probably the most important equation of the 20th century, namely E equal to mc squared, or the mass energy relations. I hope you have enjoyed this video as much as I enjoyed doing it. I would like to once again acknowledge the author of the book Introduction to Special Relativity by Robert Resnick. I urge all the students to kindly refer to this book, particularly the Wiley Student Edition 2014.